Beethoven's Fourth Symphony and Mozart's Requiem are tonight's masterworks at the Proms. And what could be more pleasant than a stroll through the wit and wonder of Beethoven's small-scale symphony and a sentimental indulgence in the death-haunted tunes of Mozart's final unfinished work? Well, think again and listen again, because this is music of shock, of revelation, of terror, and of experimental expressive extremity. Or at least it ought to be in the hands of the performers we're going to hear tonight, the BBC Scottish Symphony Orchestra, a stellar cast of soloists and conductor Donald Runicles. So, Beethoven's Fourth first. Now, this B-flat major symphony is often undervalued and taken for granted in between the behemoths that surround it, the Eroica Symphony, the Third, and the Fifth. So how's tonight's performance going to make this music as energetic and as visionary as I think it should be? I spoke to the leader of the BBC Scottish Symphony Orchestra, Laura Samuel, and to tonight's conductor, Donald Runicles. How does he approach it?
I never ever approach it with a feeling of, well, I've done this six times, so the seventh time I'm going to do this, I'm going to start slowing up there, or I'm going to do this faster, slower. Like any great work of art, you try to dig deeper and just find the essence.
Yeah.
Well, Laura, what are the challenges for you, and what's the essence of the thing for you?
Certainly as a string player, because we're often imitating wonderful single wind lines, and for example the amazing slow movement, this wonderful flute melody which we also play in the first violins, you know, to try and emulate that. Rosie, our principal flute, plays with such immaculate line and poise, and I think it is a challenge to get a large force of people to do that, and especially for our orchestra, which is often playing quite strong, rich textures. It's a real challenge, but I think everyone's loving it, and it's an incredibly inventive piece. So the more you delve, the more you find, no question.
There's something Berlioz said about the slow movement, which maybe points to the extremity, which perhaps we don't often or always think about in connection with this symphony, where he described the slow movement as if it was the Archangel Michael contemplating melancholically the cosmos and the Empyrean. I wonder, do you feel it like that, Donald?
I don't think I'll have the nerve to begin that movement now.
I'm very sorry.
Thank you, Tom.
We'll start it without you, don't worry.
Yes. I think Hector Berlioz was always... I mean, the guy was constantly high, we know that. He was always smoking something, and so he came up with the most picturesque, theatrical and dramatic explanations for pieces of music, where there is, jesting aside, there's an essence of truth there, and you feel as if so often in these movements you're coming in on the middle of a movement. There's not a beginning. It began a long, long time ago. We've opened the door and come into this remarkable world, and even though it's the Fourth Symphony, the Ninth Symphony is lurking already.
Where do you hear that?
I hear it in the open, the very opening. There's this feeling of if Beethoven had written a work called The Creation, I think that's how his creation would have begun. Mm-hmm. There is a feeling at the beginning of just these mists that's grey, and sort of spectral themes appearing and disappearing, and then of course there is this feeling of from darkness to light, mm-hmm. leading into the actual Allegro. I know this quite well. It's like watching the San Francisco fog burn off, you know, the day starts grey, and you think this is never going to burn off, and then it does, and you feel as if each day you're experiencing the colour blue for the first time. Well, that's analogous to what happens, I think, in this remarkable introduction.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's a performance to scotch, literally, the idea that that's a kind of the Cinderella symphony in Beethoven's canon. It doesn't matter the fourth symphony because it looks forward to even the ninth symphony, as Donald Runicles was telling me before the performance. There are things in that piece that happen only in Beethoven's fourth symphony. The churning dissonances in the final movement, where you felt the strings are kind of fighting each other, and moments in the slow movement and the first movement too. There's a harmonic thing that happens in the slow movement. The music seems to go down and down and down into the kind of bowels of the earth. Then there's a kind of aftershock, and there's some of the sparest, most exposed orchestral writing that Beethoven ever achieved. Solo bassoon, six times repeats the same figure, the timpani the same thing. So this isn't a piece that matters because it's about something else or because it's going somewhere else. It simply is completely itself. The next and final piece on tonight's programme, in more ways than one, is Mozart's Requiem. Donald Runicles is going to conduct the BBC Scottish Symphony Orchestra, and we're also going to hear the massed voices of the National Youth Choir of Scotland and four world-class British soloists. And it's not just vocal solos either. Instrumental ones too are really important in this piece. Becky Smith is the BBC Scottish Symphony Orchestra's second trombone player.
The movement prior to the Tuba Mirum is quite manic and fast and loud, and it just finishes quite abruptly, and then it's silence, and then you just have to start. So, yeah, that's quite challenging.
But you have got the instrument.
I have.
You know, we are surrounded by the Proms cue. So, you know, they could be very lucky if you were going to play us.
They could be.
Or give us a sneak preview of this solo.
Yeah. Okay. Shall I do it? Okay.
Yeah, sure.
I'll give it a go.
Fantastic. Round of applause, everyone, for Becky.
Thank you.
That was the trombone solo from the Tuba Mirum from the Requiem, consoling music that comes after the lashing, hellish strokes of the Dies Irae. Now, that's a musical fragment that comes from a bigger fragment, the music that Mozart actually managed to finish of the Requiem, which isn't actually that much. After his death on the 5th of December 1791, his widow Constanze needed to get the Requiem completed, and the task eventually fell to the young composer Franz Xaver Süssmayr. However, we're not going to hear the Süssmayr version tonight, which is still the one that's most often performed. Instead, Donald Runicles has chosen the version, the completion, by the forte pianist Robert D. Levin.
It's a journey. I think there's still a feeling of from the beginning of this work to 15 minutes later to the end of the work, each and every one of us either performing or listening to it has been taken on a very important journey. And this is the world of Don Giovanni. This is arguably his finest opera. One has this feeling of the specter of the commendatore, the one who basically comes in and shakes Don Giovanni's hand, and with that, the end is nigh. And I happen to love the film Amadeus, by the way. I hope it was like that in some ways. But,
part of Salieri poisoning.
I love a good conspiracy theory. But I think more importantly that the and that's once again that something Bob has very successfully managed to capture is this dark world, the spectre which is always there, no matter how beautiful, no matter how serene, no matter how tranquil, all of a sudden. And isn't that Mozart's genius, that within a couple of bars you're suddenly reminded that there's a dark side to it all. It's a little like Mahler's 10th symphony, or there's not a last word on this, because the last word would have been with the composer who sadly left before it was ended.
So, not the last word, but at least the next word on Mozart's Requiem right now at the Royal Albert Hall. And believe me, tonight's singers, those visceral, vociferous voices of the National Youth Choir of Scotland, aren't standing up there on the Royal Albert Hall stage thinking about the competing versions of Mozart's Requiem. No, they want to take us on that journey through the dark sides and consolations of Mozart's and everyone else's music.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
this piece really is not just a meditation on, but it really is, it's a confrontation with death, with mortality, with Mozart's own and the rest of ours too. And tonight, watching those young people go absolutely defiantly and fearlessly through the veil of Mozart's music with such complete conviction, I mean, it's shatteringly powerful, that. It's going to stay with me a long time.